So hi everyone. Thank you, Paul, for the introduction. Again, my name is Benedek Gagyi. I'm a software engineer at LogMeIn and also a teacher at Training 360. I usually teach front-end technologies to people. And today I'm going to talk about front-end fatigue and more precisely about ways you can actually fight it. So for those of you who don't know, front-end fatigue is actually the state of mind when you're just sick and tired of this blazing speed that the front-end technology is moving right now. Like, so many things are coming out, you just feel that you can't keep up. You feel that you don't want to learn one more front-end technology. You feel that you don't need to download one more NPM package. You just don't care. And obviously, in an industry where constant learning is essential, this kind of state of mind is really bad for us. So we should try to avoid it. The whole discussion about front-end fatigue was started by this tweet by Pete Hunt. And while this tweet focuses on the learning curve of React, it sparked a really good discussion about the whole topic, and lots of really good blog posts and podcasts and discussions were born out of this. As you can see, this is quite a big problem with many, many aspects, many ways to approach it. For me, the interesting part is how can you teach front-end technologies in a way that it's future-proof? So how can you teach it in a limited available space of time in a way that people will be able to build on it and will be able to keep up with all the things that's happening? Well, a simple solution for that, and something we can all agree on, is you should get the basics right. Right? It's quite simple. If you have really good basics, you can build upon them. Well, the thing is that while we are all agreeing on this, it's kind of hard to define what the basics exactly are. So I did a little experiment. I created a questionnaire. It had 9 interview-style JavaScript questions, but I wasn't interested in the answer to those questions. I was interested if you think that someone with a basic or advanced knowledge is able to answer this question. So there were more than 3 questions, but I'm going to only highlight 3 for you guys. The first one goes like this. What is the difference between the module pattern and the revealing module pattern in the JavaScript world? So please raise your hand if you're not tired already of raising your hands. If you think that someone with a basic JavaScript knowledge should be able to answer this question. Okay, okay. You kind of agree with the people who completed my survey because only 10% of them said that this is something basic. And for me, this question is interesting because a few years ago, this was like one of the first questions at interviews. But since then, it has become obsolete. So when you're thinking about the basics, you have to really take into account that the industry is moving really fast. Something that was basic stuff has become obsolete in just a few years. Another question was a coding type of question. The question here is, what will be printed by the console? So again, you know the drill. Please raise your hand if you think that someone with the basic knowledge should be able to answer this question. Okay, okay. I like that you're in sync with the people who completed my survey because a bit more than half of them said that this is a basic knowledge. And again, I highlighted this question because ES6 is, I think, and I feel, it's right now in the middle. Some people already consider it basic, and some people still think that it's kind of not, it's not an advanced topic because not all the browsers support it. In this case, of course, it wasn't about just syntactic sugar. You needed to know what's the difference between regular functions and arrow functions and how they handle this keyword. The last question I'm going to highlight, here the question is, which line will throw a syntax error and why? The problem is that you can't see, but in the second row, there's one more parenthesis at the end. So, who thinks that this is a basic question? Hmm, okay, okay, this is the first time you don't really agree with my responders. Maybe because you can't see all of it. The point here was that I think this is a great example for things that there are many things that we use and we're pretty confident in using them, but we don't really understand how it works. So in this case, yeah, you know that you have to put the parentheses before the iffy, but many people consider that you don't really need to know why you're doing that. This is a typical example for knowing what's the difference between declarations and statements. So anyway, for me, the main takeaway from this questionnaire was that it's really hard to define a standard. And by standard, I mean one definite basic set of knowledge that we can all build on. And if you think about it, this is kind of a big responsibility, because every time you're mentoring someone, you're teaching someone, you have to think about, okay, for them, in this particular case, what should be the basic? Where should we start from? And I think that's a challenge, but it's also liberating. It's a great freedom, because you can tailor what you're saying for everyone. You're not teaching them to achieve a given level. It's not like in school where everyone has to pass the same exam independent from their background. You can take into account everybody's background, and that's I think that's really cool. But does this mean that every time when we're teaching, we have to build all the lessons and everything from ground up? That doesn't seem really performant, not really effective. And as Paul said in his opening talk, right now we're lacking teaching, we're lacking mentoring. So if this process is really hard, then nobody will enter it. My take on this problem is that this is where we are right now, but in the future it will get a lot easier because we'll get more experience in teaching JavaScript. Just a quick test. How many of you have learned JavaScript at the university? Again, hands up. I promise this is the last one. Not too many people, right? So most of us learn JavaScript by ourselves, and there's no problem with that. It's just that we don't really have experience in teaching it. Tudor mentioned in his presentation that Stanford just introduced JavaScript to their curriculum, and it was a big thing, like Twitter was following it. Like, I hope in a few years we'll have a lot more experience in this topic, and we won't be amazed by people teaching JavaScript. And in the same time, I think we should share more of our experiences. Like, I come from a background where I usually teach in the classic way, like I'm standing in front of a class, but there are a lot more many ways to do teaching. And even a simple situation when you explain something for a colleague and they don't get it for the first time, then you kind of realize which are the hard part, where you should focus on. And I think we should share this information. If we could share it, we could get better at teaching. So right now, I'm going to share my experiences from the last 2 years of teaching JavaScript. Be aware, this is a really subjective part. So I'm actually looking forward on sparking discussions. So if in 2 weeks, Medium will be full of articles telling how wrong I was, I will be really happy, because it means that we started a discussion. So anyway, in my experience, the first thing you should do, and it doesn't matter if the people who you're teaching are total beginners or really good programmers, but they don't know front-end technologies, the first thing you should do is give them really basic building blocks. Just to give them something they can try out, something, a way to build something that works. Because these early successes are really important to get traction with the technology. If it's really hard, it takes like weeks to even make the simplest application, you won't really feel that motivated to actually learn it. So in my experience in the front-end world, and especially in the JavaScript world, the building blocks are code literacy. Obviously, you need to be able to read and write the code. Working with basic DOM elements, using Ajax, preferably with promises. As you heard a few minutes ago, promises, even though that async await is coming, are still important. Async await is based on promises, so I think you should definitely learn them. And also some really simple basic performance concepts, like how the event loop works, how async works, really from really, really far away, how the garbage collector works. Okay. But you have a bunch of Lego blocks. You give it to two different people, and they will build two different castles using the same blocks. So I think when you're teaching, you have to really pay attention to the people, to your target audience's background. So here, I'm going to share a few experiences. For me, it was a surprise that for total beginners, starting out with ES6 syntax was easier. But think about it, ES6 is a lot cleaner syntactically, a lot more logical, And they have the time later on in their careers to actually learn the historical reasons why something is like that, something is different. They have time for it. Right now, ES6, even though by the question it wasn't, so many people don't think it's a basic knowledge, I think it's really useful for them. Also, I saw that for total beginners, the fact that in JavaScript functions are first-class objects is a bit confusing. So the fact that you can return them and do all kind of magic with them is a bit tricky. I usually put a bit more emphasis on that. Also, what I don't really like to do is do a lot of deep dive into topics. So for total beginners, it's a lot more important to be able to start, coding, get going. It's like with driving. When you're learning to drive, you don't start out with learning how the motor works, how the car is built. You start out by actually driving. And later on, if you want to become a race driver, you need to learn all that stuff also. But at the beginning, I think going really deep is not that important. Another group of people I have experience with is people coming over from Java, C#, C++, so people used to classical OOP languages. Here, one thing I like to put a bit more emphasis on is the scope, the this keyword, how it all works, working with objects, because usually people coming over from these languages are really class happy. They like to solve every problem with a new class. And in JavaScript, being a bit more dynamical language, there are a lot simpler and more elegant ways to solve this by using simple objects. Also, I heard it so many times that JavaScript is not even a real programming language because they couldn't get classes right. No, they didn't want to get classes right. JavaScript is a prototype-based OOP language. And the difference between the two, although it's minor and although it's kind of hidden with the ES6 class syntax, it's still there. And I think it's important to be aware, even on a even if it's on only a high level, that there's a difference. You may have seen observed that I didn't mention a few things. One group is the tools. I think that tools are the fastest to come and go. So when you're teaching, when your point is to kind of protect people from the JavaScript and front-end fatigue, you don't really need to talk for them about tools. It's like when a junior programmer joins a team, they don't really need to understand how Webpack works. They just need to know how npm start should be typed and enter, and that's it. Later on, they will need to understand it, and they will need to learn it. But at the beginning, I don't think it's that important. Another thing I didn't touch was frameworks. The thing with frameworks is that if you know that a given target audience will use one framework, then go ahead, teach it to them. But if you don't know what they will use, I think going with one framework and then immediately after going with another one is really confusing. Instead, I'd go with the building blocks that build up the frameworks. For example, for Angular 2, I talk about RxJS, observables, TypeScript, stuff like that, how decorators work. So the building blocks that build up the framework, so when they actually arrive to that point where they have to learn about it, they already know all the sub-things that build up the big picture. My topic is titled Frontend Fatigue. And I haven't talked about CSS. And the reason is that CSS is kind of a different kind of animal, meaning that there's a saying, one of my colleagues used to say this, that you can't learn CSS, you can only get used to it. And if you think about it, that's kind of right, because we have more than 360 properties there, and each of those have many, many possible values to fill with. So you can only learn these through experience. But I think the basics, the really, really basics, are actually really simple. And while with JavaScript, I don't think it's easy to agree on a definite basic set of knowledge, with CSS, I think it is. I think if you understand these three concepts, then you're good to go. You just need to build up the experience. So these three things, in my point of view, are selectors, how they work, how can you write efficient selectors, the box model, and positioning. Absolute, relative, stuff like that. The thing with positioning is that I think you also need to add a few patterns, like how we solve typical problems, you know, vertically in the middle, horizontally in the middle. You guys know what I'm talking about. But with these three tools, they can start out. Obviously, in a few years, when we have full Flexbox support and support for Grid, we'll need to add those two, because those are kind of a bit more complicated and bigger topics in themselves. But right now, I think these three are kind of enough. So, okay, I talked about how to teach beginners, but what about all the other people who are trying to keep up, trying to constantly see what's happening? Well, this is, again, a really complicated topic, and I try to cram it up into one mathematical formula. So this formula doesn't have a cool name yet. Usually formulas have cool names like Cauchy-Bunyakovsky-Schwarz and stuff like that. This one doesn't have one, so if somebody has a good idea, just tweet it to me and I buy you a beer if I like it. And the second thing you may see about this is that it's not really mathematically correct, but I think it helps us to envision what our possibilities are. So TS is time available for studying. VL is the speed of learning stuff. And MSL is also amount of stuff to learn. And if this inequality holds true, it means that you're all right. It means that if the combination of your time and the speed of learning is still bigger than the amount of stuff that you think you need to learn, you're all right. When the amount of stuff is getting more and more and more, and you feel that you can't keep up, that's when front-end fatigue happens. So if you look at this formula, you can clearly see we have three ways where we can affect this. First, by making more time for studying. Well, I think this is kind of like a brute force solution, and this is like the fastest way for burning out, but sometimes you need it. Sometimes you just have to put your ass down and start learning. But again, this is not a sustainable thing. But there are hacks. I've talked to many people, and everyone has different hacks. I share mine. For example, I usually watch YouTube videos sped up, and while washing the dishes or doing the ironing. It's like, instead of 20 minutes, it's like 15 minutes, and you learn something. Maybe you have other tricks. Like, I know people who are listening to podcasts while traveling the train, stuff like that. But the point is here that this is not where you should focus on. I think what you should focus on is improve learning speed. This is something that's... This is not a talent. This is a skill. It has to be achieved. You have to work for it. But if you have good basics, like we talked before, I think it's easier to achieve this. So if you know of any white holes in your knowledge, filling them may speed you up. Also, an important thing here to note is that we have a ton of resources on the internet that can help you learn. Just type in Angular tutorial, and you'll get like an unlimited amount of tutorials. Which one do you choose? Maybe one of these will really be perfect for you, will be a match for your way of thinking, and you'll be done in an hour. And another one is kind of really weird, and you don't really understand what they mean. You have to reread it, stuff like that. So I think a thing that many people miss is actually looking through the wide selection of tutorials and actually selecting the ones that are best for you. And I'd like to ask you guys, please, write even more tutorials. It's not like we don't have enough. The thing is that there are so many ways to understand one concept and so many ways to explain it. We can always use one more explanation. So if you had a simple problem that you spent an afternoon solving and you finally have the solution, please write a small post about it. Post it on Twitter or Medium, anywhere you want it, so that we can have more knowledge as a community about these things. And here, I'd like to make a quick detour and talk about DX, developer experience, or how Xavier called it, developer efficiency. The thing is here that right now the internet is a really big free market. Like, nobody's stopping you to copy one of the frameworks, do two small modifications, call it something else, and then publish it. Nobody's stopping you. And actually, if you publish the exact same thing, but it's a bit more developer-friendly, there's a good chance that all the people who were using the other one will start to use your thing. So a really good example for this problem is when CTOs and leaders are choosing a new framework. Usually, the things they consider are performance over everything, maybe community background, stuff like that. But my point here is that you should also take into account how the developer experience is. In my opinion, there's always a bit of distance between being able to write working code in any framework or any library and being able to write the best possible code in that library. Just think about, there are many articles that are comparing, for example, Angular and React speed. And the comment section is always full of people telling that if you do this, it will be a bit faster, and if you do that, it will be faster. For me, what I read from this is that it's not trivial to achieve that performance. I don't care if your car can go really, really fast if I can't make it really, really go really, really fast. So usually when a CTO chooses a framework or a language, they think about them themselves, but I urge you guys to think about all the people who are going to work with that. Most of us are not seniors. Most of the people writing code today don't have that much experience, and especially, this is especially true in JavaScript and front-end technologies. So please, take into consideration how much time they will need to actually perform good with the given technology. So if there's one thing you take away from my talk, it should be this. Developer experience is just as important as performance, in my point of view. Okay, let's get back to the magical formula. The last thing you can do is manage your backlog. The thing is, if you were paying attention, I said that this is the amount of stuff you feel that you should learn. Obviously, nobody is going to come and tell you this is the stuff that you need to learn. Maybe your boss will, but hey, you can disagree with him. So the thing is that you have to manage this yourself. And for me, a really big breakthrough was when I started having a written backlog. Okay, I'm not having a Jira board for myself, let's be clear, but actually, writing stuff down is really useful because it kind of protects you from all the hype that's happening. Because imagine a situation, your Twitter feed is full of a new technology, of a new idea. If you don't have a backlog, you start to research it, but it's complicated, you don't really have the time. Then a few days later, you see it again on Twitter, then you feel bad that, ooh, I haven't really understood that. So it's like a frustration. But if you just take 5 minutes to understand how important that is to you at the moment, to give it a priority, and then put it in a backlog, you can chill, because the next time you have a bit of free time, you just look at your backlog and see, okay, what is the most important right now for me? And my experience is that most of the things that are really hyped usually end up at the bottom of the backlog. And of course, you should know about as many things as possible, but our time is limited, and we should use it well. Also, another idea that I'd put here is that we should be aware of our cognitive biases. So people usually, even in a subconscious level, try to defend their past decisions. So if you choose something in the past, and then later on you have to choose between two things, and one of them will support your decision in the past, you will tend to go that way. So if you pay attention to this consciously, and you try to train yourself in the areas where you're actually bad at, it will be a lot easier to make educated decisions later on. And the last idea I'd like to share with you is actually an idea that I got from a runner. He told me that sometimes if you want to keep running, you have to stop for a second and just enjoy, and just be patient and look around and sink in to that moment. Right now in the front-end world, we have an incredible speed. Many things are coming and going, but if you take one step back and just look around, you may realize that this is the best time to write front-end code. We have really great tools, huge communities. It's never been easier to ship something, a feature, for our users. So even though it may seem like everybody's running around headlessly, actually, it's a really great time to join the front-end community. So if front-end fatigue is stopping you from doing this, just take a second, relax, and you'll be all right. Thank you for your attention. We have a few questions. I'll try to be quick so you can go and grab lunch. How do you motivate people to learn concepts and paradigms before frameworks? Well, motivation is like, again, a different topic. because for many people, the problem with front-end fatigue that they want to learn, but they feel that they can't. For other people, it's they lack the motivation. So this is like a really big topic, but I think if you explain your points, explain that, okay, even though you may feel that you need to learn this framework or that framework, paradigms in the long run will help you more, I think people will understand. And obviously, this is a really short explanation. You should expand it a bit. But I think sensible people will understand the difference. What about front-end hunger? What do we have for lunch? I don't know what we have for lunch. But actually, for those who think that the front-end world isn't moving fast enough right now, I think I have good news. It's going to become even more faster. Do you think that there's a strong connection between JS fatigue, lack of sports activity, and bad eating habits? I know it's a joke, but actually, I think there is. Like the your motivation and hunger for knowledge can be only present when you're healthy. Like, I had days when I was at home lying with a sickness, and I just couldn't watch even the shortest video because you can't concentrate. So guys, please take care of yourself so you can learn JavaScript. In Soviet Russia, ES6 begins you. Well, I don't know about that. does it really matter if JS is taught in schools, or it is more important to know basic programming paradigms and patterns? Oh, I love this question. This is a really good question. I think for beginners, it's not important to learn a language. I don't care if it's JavaScript, it's Java, C. For them, it's important to get successes, to get as really, really fast to a point where they can actually make their ideas real, make their ideas happen. So when I had a non-profit organization where I was teaching people who had no programming experience programming, and I started with a language called processing. This language was created for artists, so they can create really nice-looking stuff with minimal code. But it's really good for teaching, because it has the basic concept. It has variables, loops, stuff like that. But in, like, I don't know, this much code, you can program a simple game. And it was so good to see that people were actually invested in their code. And I think the actual motivation comes from the part where you don't really care about the code. You care about the features that you're building. When the code is just a tool, it's just a means. So yeah, I don't care where programming is taught, but right now we need so many new people in the workforce that, yeah, also teaching it in schools is one of the options. Is it safe to assume that fatigue exists strictly because budding developers don't have a grasp on the JavaScript core? I'm not sure I agree. Maybe there are situations where a better understanding would help you a lot. But I think that right now the problem is actually real, that we have too many things that do the same thing. We have too many build systems where the parts are actually glued together with duct tape and magic. So, but the good news is that this is all getting better. Like, if you look at the newest tools, they try to integrate all the things that a few years ago we did with different ones. So I think we're heading in the right direction. Opinions on left pad fiasco? Don't you agree that most of the communities relies too much on NPM packages and forgot how to properly code by themselves? Oh, there were so many good articles about the left pad fiasco. I don't think I can put anything into that discussion. Like, everything was said before. There are pros and cons of using all these NPM packages. I agree that there's a problem. Like, last week I opened our product and I counted how many NPM packages we're using. We're using more than 1,000. I agree, that's a bit too much. And it's not a problem of using yarn or NPM, it's a problem of too many dependencies. Yeah, this is something we should work on as a community, but I don't think it can be solved in a few words. It's a really deep topic. Do you have a website blog where you share your teacher experience? This is the best question, because most of my experiences, I haven't shared them yet. It's actually when I was preparing for this talk, was the moment when I realized that we lack this kind of topics. There are so many things we talk about as a community, and teaching is somehow not one of them. So yeah, I will be sharing it, and please join me in doing so. What does budding mean? I have an idea, but I'm not sure, so I'm not going to make a fool out of myself. You have Google it. Not reinventing the wheel means using the same wooden wheel. Reinventing the wheel in a business environment is not always a good thing. However, when teaching, yeah, I like where you're going with that. Like, I understand that taking a fresh look on things that we consider fixed is a really good habit. But in the same time, we have to stay as performant as we can. Again, Pau said in his opening presentation that if you invest too much time, too much energy into teaching, then you're removing that time from something else. So we kind of have to find a balance here. Beginners should start with JavaScript or TypeScript. What do you think? Well, I think that the thing is with me that I have a Java background. I was a full-stack Java engineer for 2 years, and then I started doing JavaScript because I like the dynamic nature. And for me, even if the restrictions are small, I kind of feel them. It's not like I hate them, but I'm not really comfortable with them. So for me, personally, the answer is kind of simple. But if you'd ask me to build a lecture for beginners, and if I had the time to go into TypeScript, I would go into it. Because by learning TypeScript, I think you can you get a better understanding what's actually happening under the hood. Like, so many people use JavaScript, and they don't even know that JavaScript has types. I think this is something that even though you don't have to use them explicitly, you have to be aware of them. In general, I think TypeScript is a really cool direction, but I also think that it won't ever kill JavaScript in total. JavaScript will be there for the long run. Maybe WebAssembly will kill JavaScript, but that's a totally different topic. Is front-end fatigue a really thing? It sounds really made up. yeah, fake news. Well, the thing is that if you haven't experienced it, then you're doing something right. So if you haven't experienced this yet, and you feel that all this talk was kind of senseless, then please take a second and think about your habits. What are you doing? Maybe share them. How are you learning new stuff? How are you introducing new ideas to your code base? Please share that information. Maybe you found one solution for the problem. Is the exact level of details for the basics needed? Isn't it more important to grow a healthy mindset? Yeah, I totally agree with that. Like the mindset is the most important, but on the other hand, when you have like 5 days, and after those 5 days, a group of people will start working in a team, you actually need to teach them something. Like, mindsets are cool. I don't think that they can be taught easily, but technology can be taught, even if it's not trivial. So yeah, mindsets are important, but also please try to teach something. Thoughts on using CLI to teach people frameworks? Oh, I love this question. Because I had a really good experience with LearnUNode. LearnUNode is actually I'm not sure what it is, but it's a website where they have really good Node tutorials, and they have a CLI based tutorial. And I had such a good experience with that. Like, it works offline, it has all the info needed, it even had the NPM packages already included. So if you were working offline and one of the exercises needed an NPM package, you could just copy-paste it from the tutorials directory. I really like this direction, and like I mentioned before, good tutorials are really important. CLI tutorials is one way to create really, really, really good tutorials. How do you fight the fatigue of choosing an entire stack of front-end technology for a project? There are too many opinions all over the web. Yeah, that's a real problem, and it's especially a problem when the people who have to make the decision don't really have experience in it. Because if you have experience, you have also biases. So maybe you have an idea which way to go. But in general, I think if you have no idea which way to go, go in the path of the least resistance. Go where the learning curve is not steep, where it's easy to learn, where it's easy to start. And also try to choose something that won't tie your hands for too long, because everything is changing. You have to prepare for changing your stack and your tools over and over and over again. Thank you, and poftă bună!